So, good morning. It's very early for us since we're out from the West Coast, but we will struggle through this. So before I get started, I'm Trudy Raymundo, obviously the Director of Public Health for San Bernardino County. And a lot of what we're gonna talk about are some of the approaches we've taken in order to improve public health outcomes for our county. But if I could get a sense, is there anybody in the room that's actually from a local health department or from public health generally? Before I start throwing out public health acronyms out there left and right. So just a few of you? Okay. So we'll go ahead and get started. So I think before I get too far into why Socrata, I think it would be helpful to talk a little bit about San Bernardino County and why we went down this road and why I really went down this idea of bringing in all of these sectors to help me out in terms of public health outcomes. So this is San Bernardino County. Interestingly enough, and we only learned this a few years ago, it actually is called the heart of Southern California. We are, in 2017, we are estimated to be well over 2 million people. One of the interesting things also is that our county stands at over 20,000 square miles. So I have a clinic that it literally takes me 3 hours to get to, if that gives you any idea in terms of the expanse. We have everything. We have rural, we have urban, so we've got it all. We're broken down into a variety of districts. We've got our Central Valley, we've got a lot of mountain area, we've got a lot of desert area. Almost 80% of our actual land mass is federally owned, so there's very little we can actually do in terms of development, which is one of the things that we struggle with. In terms of our current reality, so one of the things that you'll see is that we have an obesity epidemic, and that was kind of mentioned earlier during the first presentations. Almost 30% of our entire population over the age of 12 is considered overweight or obese. We have one of the highest RFEI, and that is Retail Food Environment Index numbers in the state. And actually what that does is it measures how many fast food or liquor store type restaurants we have versus grocery stores. And at one point we were actually the worst in the state, and I think it was like 8-1. So in any given neighborhood, you're gonna hit 8 McDonald's, liquor stores, and then eventually run into a grocery store. As I don't know if many of you know, but the seat of our county, San Bernardino City, is just now coming out of bankruptcy. So we've been in bankruptcy for quite a few years. So these are some of the things that we deal with. We have a very car-centric environment simply because of the expanse. So I thought it would be interesting to show you where Josh and I work. So that red area shows the worst pollution rates as well as the worst socioeconomic rates in the state of California. And we get to work right dead center in the middle of it. But it gives us a real perspective in terms of the complexity of the issues that we have to deal with. So when I actually came back to public health in early 2010, I was gone for about 2.5 years. And before that, I'd actually started back in 1997. So kind of given the dynamics of what I just talked about and the environment that we were facing, one of the things that I realized is that as a local health department, and we're a fairly large local health department, my budget is upwards of about 100 million. I usually try to run about 900 staff at any given time. So it's a large health department, but we obviously have a lot of issues. And so one of the things that as I was going through the process and really struggling with why we weren't making any impacts was, quite honestly, I just don't think that we were really looking at our data. We were looking at our data also very much in isolation. So I could speak to other public health folks about some of my obesity issues, but I only spoke with public health folks. I really wasn't talking to the entire community. So one of the things that we started was, you know, what if I took all of this data that we've got? And one of the things that we also did was we just didn't look at public health data. So I didn't drive in every diagnosis and every disease number I had. I brought in education numbers. I brought in crime numbers. I brought in housing numbers, homeless numbers, income stability numbers, all of these things, high school graduation rates. I brought on all of these numbers and went out into the community and really started a conversation. And I think, and now I think about it, you know, I wish that we had brought in Socrata earlier to help us drive some of these conversations with the open data portals and things like that. But, you know, for me to drive the conversations, it was just a lot of staff looking at secondary numbers, but then getting out into the community. And so I think from the perspective of how best to use data, I'm a huge proponent of using data to start a conversation. You know, you get it out there and you say, not just here's the number of high school graduation rates, but the point was, you know, here are our current graduation rates, and the conversation started with why. Why do you think this number is what it is? And what we got out of the conversation were two things. Number one, it created a real sense of urgency in our county to start coming together. I don't think that we would have worked anywhere near as closely together with some of the other sectors if we hadn't started some of these conversations. The other piece of it was interesting the stories that came out. So, you know, we were talking about, oh, you know, there are all these health issues, but the stories that came out were, well, you know what? I never graduated from high school. Because I didn't graduate from high school, I don't have a very good job. And because I don't have a very good job, I don't have health insurance. Hence why I never get to see a doctor. It was, you know what? Stop telling me that I need to get out and exercise because I'm afraid to walk out my own front door. So this idea of, you know, this idea that we were talking about in terms of built environment, things like that, it was obvious from just a public health perspective, we weren't going to solve the problem. It was obvious I needed to bring in my transportation authority. I needed to bring in my council of governments. I needed to bring in education. I needed to bring in my homeless partnerships. I needed to bring in local businesses that could drive jobs. I needed to bring in public safety to help address, okay, I'm putting in all of these bikeways and walkways and nobody's using them. Well, it's because they're afraid to walk out their front door. So it was this idea of, this, it was obvious I needed to bring in all of these other sectors. So, and one of the things that we also discovered was that if you look at this, and I don't know how easy it is to read, what you typically think of in health is that clinical care is only 20% of what drives an individual's health. The other 50% is things around education, employment, income, community safety, housing and transit. So it was infinitely, for me, much more cost effective if I focused on these rather than the 20%. I could get a much bigger bang for my buck. If I actually brought in all of the other sectors to help me deal with some of these other issues, rather than just assuming I could solve 100% of the issues with 20% of this. So we went through the process after we went into all of that is, okay, well, I have all these stories and I have all of this data. Now it was about using the data to really drive action. And so one of the things that we created what is called a community transformation plan. And for those folks that are used to public health, it is for those local health departments, city, state, county, that are going through accreditation, you have to do a community health improvement plan. So what we did was, right now my community health improvement plan is a book about this thick. It's a little daunting, it's a little difficult to get to, and certainly isn't something that I want to print in the thousands. And so what we decided was, wouldn't it be great if we took this community health improvement plan and made it much more interactive, put it on the web, and hence the Socrata, our open performance. Because one of the things in this community transformation plan was not just talking about these are the areas that we want to focus on. And when I show you screenshots of our open performance, all of our tiles, all of our open performance goals, interestingly though, even though it's our community health improvement plan, many of them revolve around education. Many of our goals revolve around homelessness and job stability. Much of it revolves around built environment. There's a large section that also revolves around public safety, not just reality of crime, perception of crime. We realized was a huge issue. And if any of you know the things that go on in California, we love to pass propositions that return folks back into our communities. So it started with AB 109, and then we have Prop 47, now Prop 57. So folks are back in our communities. And you know, I'm not gonna debate the good or the bad or the political side of it, but folks are returning into our communities. And so we really needed to deal with that from the community and public health standpoint. So one of the things that I wanted to bring up and why I'm sitting here with a chief of planning for actually our regional transportation authority is one of the areas that we focused on for our community transformation plan was actually this, around the built environment. So it wasn't so much trying to convince people that you should eat better and you should get out and exercise. It was about how do we actually create opportunities for them to do that. And the only way I was going to be able to do that was actually working through my transportation authority or my council of governments. Because it's one thing to just try to keep telling somebody to change your habits. It's a whole nother thing to make sure they had an opportunity to be able to do that. And, you know, I had just talked about our retail food environment index. Well, obviously, you know, that was the issue that needed to change. It wasn't so much I need to change your habits. It's maybe I need to change the environments that you're functioning in. And so, again, you know, access to health and wellness, these are some of our strategies. We're working very closely in active transportation plans, increasing use and access to farmers markets, policies that address zoning, to address equity issues. We are promoting a lot of safe routes to schools, one of the areas that Josh is going to talk about, that he's going to start driving data into our community vital signs platform. We're looking at adoptions of complete streets and things like that. So healthy menu. So really bringing in a whole different sector to address some real public health issues. So the other piece of why we went with and why we are actively using our open performance platform is making sure that we're also accountable. So it's one thing to sit there and say, you know, these are all the things that we're going to do, but I think the other piece of it that we needed to make sure of, and it was part of the earlier presentation, is that citizen engagement. We needed to make sure we were accountable, because having our own internal goals really means nothing, because then we're not really accountable to anything. So I wanted to make sure that our goals were always up and always present. So this is what our site looks like. And it's essentially performance at a glance. And what we wanted to make sure was that with our open performance site, it actually mirrored the priority areas within our transformation plan so that folks could get in there rather than carrying this 300-page book around. They could go into each of those sites and really take a look at these are the goals that we have. One of the goals in education is about high school graduation rates because studies show that those folks that actually graduate with a college degree will live 5 years longer than folks that never graduate with a high school degree. And so obviously mortality was a big driver for that. And what it did was also gave us an opportunity, so we were able to set up our goals. It gave us an opportunity to talk about the strategies that we had in place. And these are strategies we did not drive. We brought in folks from the education sector. So it was our superintendent of schools. It was superintendents and principals from a variety of schools represented throughout the county. They're the ones that talked about these are the strategies we should start putting into place. And this is a big thing in terms of an open portal, because we wanted to make sure the communities understood what strategies we had in place. And that was important for us, because even though I have this multi-sectoral effort and I have some key folks, I think the more you talk about strategies in there, what we're hoping is that more folks are going to raise their hand and say, hey, I'm working on that too. How can I align? It's like, hey, you know what? I have some really great resources, really great ideas around those strategies. Let me talk to you about them. So I really wanted to get the information out there in order to hopefully actually get additional input into the way we were functioning. It was also really important for us, because it's community vital signs and people naturally think it's health, I think they would have wondered why I'm showing so much education data. Why am I showing so much public safety data? So I wanted to make sure that we describe why is education important to health. They needed that story. This is one of the areas that we're working on. It's actually the San Bernardino County Cradle to Career Roadmap. So this is an area where all of the schools are working on. They are working through much of the top section. We are actually working through much of the bottom section. the personal issues, and then while they work on the educational issues. You know, one thing that we discovered is that kids don't learn very well when they just don't feel good. So our role, what we saw is, well, let's just make sure kids feel good. Let's make sure kids are healthy so that they, when they actually walk through the doors of the classroom, they're healthy enough to learn. You know, the biggest issues around absenteeism were always either asthma related or dental related. So it was either they were suffering from cavities or they were having an asthma attack. They simply couldn't breathe. Those were the biggest drivers of missed school days. So it was, how do I make sure I'm doing what I can to address this to make sure they're showing up at school and doing the best? So now I'm going to turn it over to Josh, who's going to talk about why am I working with built environment.
Thank you, Trudy. Good morning. My name is Josh Lee. I'm with San Bernardino County Transportation Authority. It's called SBCTA, but we were formerly known as SANBAG. So we recently literally was San Bernardino Associated Government, so we called ourselves SANBAG. So there's a reason why we changed it in January. So we're now called SBCTA. But there's a reason why I'm up here as well with Trudy, is that built environment also realized that we need a partnership and we can't solve our own transportation and land use issues ourselves as well. So you heard it today, kind of in the morning, two sessions, we talked about Vision Zero in the morning, talked about streets and sidewalks and so forth, and how we need to make sure that our focus is on people when we build our road system in our country. So how many folks here, so Trudy did this, so how many of you are transportation or built environment or planning folks? Okay, not many. All right, so, but, you know, as you kind of saw this morning, that there's a lot of linkages with that are going on in the built environment sector, and I think it's important to point that out. So here's two things that the main reason why we work with public health as well in our sector. You know, you saw today at the Vision Zero presentation, the first thing that they showed was, you know, the fatalities related to pedestrians. And this is the stats for our county. For 2011, we had 830 collisions, both fatality and injuries, and then 2014, 982. These are very high numbers. This is anywhere from rankings from 40th to 50th out of 58 counties in our state. So our county is going through some real challenges when it comes to safety of bicyclists and pedestrians. And then also as well, Trudy kind of talked about this, but you know, it's a commonsensical thing. You know, as you drive less, you know, your obesity rates decreases because you're using other forms of transportation modes. And as you drive more, of course, the tendency to be overweight, the tendency for obesity increases because you're just sitting around driving. So there's a lot of different sustainability programs that we're engaged in. We're working on a lot of different programs as a transportation authority in our county. And these are some of just snapshots of some of the programs that we have that are related to not only sustainability, but related to public health. And we're currently working on a lot of different active transportation programs in our county. We have a countywide Safe Out to School plan that we're finishing up, and we have a countywide pedestrian plan that we're finishing up next month as well. And then we have conservation plans, we have air quality stuff, and then regional transportation plans that we're working on. And in all of those programs, we are kind of talking about data. So, you know, I'll kind of tie the theme together with three examples that I have here. So first of all, countywide, we're finishing off with, finishing off soon with our countywide pedestrian plan. And it's basically a plan that kind of addresses 25 different locations in our county. Because as Trudy mentioned, we're a very, very large county. I can't go out and start doing sidewalk inventories and doing analysis for every single intersection. That's just impossible. So what we've done in this plan was to pick just 25 locations. We have 24 cities and then one unincorporated area. So we have 25 jurisdictions. So it kind of makes sense. Every city gets a points of interest. So what we did was we went out there, we looked at the hotspots, you saw all the analysis that you saw this morning. We've done all those analysis on those spots, and we have given location analysis results for our cities. And they've taken that analysis and kind of picked a location, and we actually walked the streets. We actually did the walk audits and bike audits for those locations and came up with recommendations on how to improve those streets. But again, all of these efforts started out with a data analysis. Without this geospatial analysis that we've gone through, this is impossible. So Safe Fox School, Trudy also talked about Safe Fox School as well, but we're working with the Department of Public Health to do a lot of Safe Fox School work in our county. So we're kind of finishing off with our Safe Fox School plan at this point. But that Safe Fox School plan kind of addresses all five criteria areas for Safe Fox. When we talk about Safe Fox, this is getting our kids to walk and bike more to school. Kind of makes sense, right? How many of you have walked and biked when you guys were growing up to school, right? How many of your kids are actually walking and biking to school? See, like one. See, so something changed in the last few decades that we're no longer letting our kids walk and bike to school. So why is that? So we're addressing education, we're addressing encouragement, we're addressing enforcement issues. Engineering issues, that's the most costly one because it's very expensive to fix infrastructure. But we also have evaluation piece. So we actually go out to the community. We actually go out to each of the school sites. We've picked about 55 schools because we have 550 public schools in our county. And in those 55 schools, we asked the parents what the issues are. We've done student surveys. We asked the teachers. We asked the administrators what the issues are and what the problem is basically for why kids are not walking and biking to school. So all of the data is kind of collected, and this is one of the methods that we use to collect those data. It's a very data-driven format. Another example that I like to point out is, we're a transportation agency, so we do a lot of modeling work. That modeling work has a lot of data involved in it. So this is something that's kind of cool. We're working with our regional MPO, SCAD, Southern California Associated Government, to kind of work on a model that, when you have a certain land use or transportation changes, what kind of impact does it bring to our infrastructure, to our public health system, and to our water, air quality, and so forth. So we kind of came up with this assumptions and modeling work, and then the left one is kind of our assumptions related to public health. If we make X amount of infrastructure change, what kind of behavioral change does it have for people in terms of walking and biking? And how much change does what kind of health indicators does it affect? So there's a reason why I bring all these up. It's because a lot of our data kind of lives in silos. So all these programs that we've developed, kind of, we go to the different program websites and we kind of go through the data and we just data dump everything in those areas. So I have, if you know transportation and land use sector, we collect tons of information. We have sometimes just data that's just sitting there in our database that, we often don't even use. And so, we need to prioritize what we collect and what we use. So that's why we partner with public health to kind of drill down into access to public health, access to health and wellness, icon, to kind of come up with what she did with the education sector. So that's our next step. What we're working on currently is we've identified some funding to do that and come up with our own dashboard and performance monitoring tool so that we can actually look at some of these changes over time for, increasing our kids walking and biking to school and so forth. So that's our next plan. So the key point is we have a lot of data. We need to actually make sure that they're housed in one location and so that we can actually track and monitor our performances. So if we don't do that, if we just keep doing what we've always been doing, we end up with this. We talked about, Dan kind of stole my thunder this morning, but we've kind of lost focus on how we build our infrastructure. So we lost focus, and this is how most of our transportation systems are built. This is the same as this, basically. So again, we need to go back to where we came from and start building our infrastructure and start collecting data for people.
So, and I love this quote, you know, if you want to go fast, go alone, but if you want to go far, go with others. And really that has been kind of the primary focus of the way we've been functioning in San Bernardino, is really collaborating with others, making sure that we are utilizing the expertise, the experience, the skills, and absolutely the data from everybody else. From public health, we have a lot of data. We collect data constantly, but what we're discovering is sometimes it's just not the relevant data. It's not data that anybody cares about. It's not the data that's important to them. So the reason behind us kind of creating that multi-sectoral single site is to actually bring in important data, but take it to a place where you only go to the one site. It gives you the relevant data that you're looking for related to health, whether it's education, the transportation data, public safety, crime data, things like that, that actually are affecting the community and their health, and making sure that it is accessible, because ultimately our goal is not just citizens being able to use it, but policymakers. So I have a city council member and he really wants to advocate budgeting a lot for complete streets and things like that. What a great way to use our site. Bring it in, have him go to a single place where he can pull up existing transportation data, also then pull in obesity data for his relevant population and make that presentation to his entire city council. And he can get it all from one place and have the data and the stories to be able to relay. So that is where we are. Before I open it up to questions, I promised I would do two plugs. So I get to get up really early tomorrow morning because I will be hosting a health meetup at breakfast tomorrow at 7:30. And then please join us. I know we flew through these really quickly and you just got some snapshots of our sites, but I will also be at Demo Alley tomorrow afternoon from 3 to 3:40. And so with that, I don't know if we have any time for questions, but thank you. Do we have time for questions? Oh, okay. Questions? Yes.
I have a mic, hold on one second.
Yeah, so we're starting right now with secondary data. So things that we're pulling from other sources. A large data set that we use is CHIS, actually. It's a California Health Interview Survey data. It is in a county as large as ours with that many local jurisdictions, it's gonna be tough for us to find localized data and consolidate all, but that is our next step, is actually being able to do that. We're hoping education is a huge piece of that, where they start to get real school district data, and so that we can actually start to look at school district data, school district absenteeism, and then look at our asthma rates, perhaps in that area, and really hone in as to why, you know, why something is happening in a particular school.
So I skipped through it really fast, but this model that we have, in order to calculate the health benefits or health outcomes, we have to have, we're using the CHIS, very CHIS data that Trudy has in the public health realm to come up with those assumptions. So, you know, data, public health data is also integrated with various other sector data.
I guess collaboration between public agencies is something that you've always strived to do. Mm-hmm. Is there something magical about using data that's actually made a difference?
I think it is, because I think it is when folks see how the decision they made. So it was a decision they made, and this was the data that came as a result of your decision. What we did was actually show them how it correlated into the other sectors. Because oftentimes sectors love to make decisions and they're like this. They don't consider the impact or how it's interrelated to the other sectors. And so we actually really use data to say, you know, you keep transportation sector, you keep making these decisions, but from, you know, and this is the data that shows this, now look at the data as a result to it. You know, these are the things, these are the impacts you're making in all of these other sectors. High school graduation rates was a perfect example. I think for folks in the education sector, they get focused on that education piece of it, but then when we told them, oh, but did you know that, you know, if you don't graduate with a high school degree, the likelihood that you're gonna live an additional 5 years beyond folks that have a college degree, I think that was incredibly telling for them.
So I guess for us, if I may add, this helped incredibly. This is something called social determinant health. And all, you know, it's just a diagram here, but in each of the elements, we have ample data to back up why we're relevant in terms of public health now. So I think a lot of that helped. And I think this very conference that says lead with data, the data is basically the backbone of all these percentages that we see.
Well, one of the things you mentioned is changing perceptions of school safety or safety in general. Most people rely on surveys to get that information, but they can be really expensive to conduct on a routine basis. Have you found other solutions to really tap into community relations or even perceptions?
Well, and I'm hoping that sometimes part of that is just getting communities to come in and interact. So if we can get them secondary data, even just showing them these are some of the crime rates, because perceptions of safety is and the reality of safety are actually two completely separate things. And I had not realized that until I actually sat down and decided to talk to my sheriff and bringing that back to the community. So I think once you actually kind of show them the data around realities of crime and then talk about the perceptions of crime and perceptions of safety, but again, it's kind of using data, real data, to drive, all right, so if this is the real data, what's actually happening in your community? Is it actually happening? Or are there things that we should be working with in conjunction with other sectors to help alleviate or mitigate some of the perceptions? But you're right, us getting local data is gonna be really expensive. Yeah, that one I think everybody is you know, agreed on. But I think there are some areas where we're discovering we're gonna have to do that, but we're starting with secondary data, having the conversation saying, okay, what's gonna be most important for you? Okay, now let's make the investment to get that localized data.